presentation as it is in the cloud. I will talk about scientific computation and simulation, especially in the case of new body simulations, astrophysical actually. The structure of the presentation is as follows. With a quick introduction of extant and emerging architectures for scientific computation on the cloud. Then an introduction to basic new body simulations, introduction to methods actually. The next section is a use case concerning the evolution of a galaxy, a Milky Way type galaxy actually. Then conclusions and future directions, and finally some notable references concerning the research. So, cloud environments are very popular nowadays because of the flexibility they offer, as well as the resiliency of both software and hardware. According to Forbes, 92% of the total workloads will be run on cloud environments until 2020. There are three basic models, the infrastructure as a service, the software as a service, and the platform as a service, with the second one being the most popular of them all. It's estimated that 74% of the delivery models will be software as a service by 2020. Recently, new architectures have been proposed. The ones are the workflow as a service, for example, or hybrids of the above. This is done in the cloud lightning. These architectures were proposed to tackle the HPC migration problem to cloud environments. These delivery models can be used to conduct simulations in engineering and multi-physics domains. For example, computational fluid dynamics simulations, astrophysical simulations, simulations related to fabrication of new materials, and things like that. These simulations, till today, are mostly conducted on premises by using supercomputing infrastructures of universities or research centers. Recently, more of this, there are a lot of simulation environments, multiphysics or engineering simulation environments that migrated to the cloud. For example, the ANSYS, the SolidWorks, and the COMSOL, which are general purpose simulation environments, they started offering choices under license to run applications on the cloud that could auto-scale or, for example, pick the best combinations of software to run specific simulation based on user inputs. It's a very promising approach since the scientist need not consume his time, let's say, tuning the application or searching for experts that will tune the application for him. So this process, the clouds automate this process. Various scientific applications, academic-wise scientific applications, also started migrating to the cloud. One of these applications is new body simulation. New body simulation is the study of a dynamical system of particles under prescribed forces, electrostatic forces, or U1C forces, or gravitational forces. New body simulations are primarily used for conducting cosmological simulations or galactic simulations, solar system simulations, studying phenomena of evolution, let's say bars and spirals of galaxies. It's one of the main tools for understanding the universe. So there have been several methods that have been proposed. The most classic one is the direct methods. They are good for simulations of about 10 to the fifth particles with a complexity ranging, with a complexity close to n squared. These types of methods are used for small-scale simulations, for example, studying the trajectory of an asteroid or our solar system. Then there are the trick codes, which have a complexity of n times log n. The fast multiple methods that are of complexity on, but this is debated a lot in the literature. They say that the on is very application-specific. And in the end are the particle mesh codes, which are usually used for very large simulations, where they do not scale with the number of bodies, they scale with the number of grid points, which is far less than the number of bodies. Actually, the choice of the method depends highly on what you want to simulate. For example, solar systems have tens of bodies, so you don't have to use, for example, tree codes or fast multiple methods or particle mass methods. You can use direct methods. Then galaxies have bodies in the order of 10 to the 6th. Finally, cosmological simulations, which study the evolution of the universe, are close to 10 to the 10th number of bodies. This is not presented well. So here I was explaining the basic methods. The direct methods compute all the force pairs between the bodies. So if you have 10 million bodies, you have to compute 10 million times 10 million force pairs. The tree codes divide the space where these bodies reside in divided continuously, forming oak trees and computing the forces, the far forces less accurately to reduce this this complexity. Then the fast multiple methods use the same idea, however, for bodies that are relatively close, they use the same approximation to further reduce the complexity. The particle mass methods use another approach. They solve the gravitational equation, which is a Poisson type equation, partial differential equation, using either fast Fourier transforms or highly efficient multi-grid methods, interpolate the gravitational potential, use it to compute the acceleration, integrate the equations of motion, and then proceed to the next time step. This is highly efficient. These methods are highly efficient. They're, complexity is O and G, as I said before, so they can be used for conducting simulations that are extremely large. The largest one of them was conducted at the Garting Supercomputing Center in Germany. This is called the Millennium Simulation, the Millennium Run. It had 10 to the 10 number of bodies, forming 2 times 10 to the 7 galaxies in a 2 billion light year box. The simulation was running for more than a month in the whole supercomputing center. The data, the output data, are in the order of 25 terabytes. And before post-processing, this is just numbers, 25 terabytes of numbers. So the requirements for such simulations are unimaginably big, are enormous. And the computational power required is also enormous. Another issue is that these examples are not conducted a single time. They have to be re-executed multiple times with different, slightly different inputs, so you can study the evolution and how much each parameter affects this evolution. So, now we go to what we do. We are actually developed a code that is based on the particle mass method and can be used for galaxy scale simulation. The code uses the multi-grid methods in conjunction with approximate inverses, and then it goes and refines sections where density is very high to capture very small phenomena. This can be performed in parallel. How it can be performed? These small Nyquist problems are independent of each other. So when we form the overlapping grids, we can assign each overlapping grid to a thread. So this can be, this achieves almost theoretical peak in efficiency. This is an overview of the algorithm. We load the initial conditions for the bodies and the physical system. We employ a loop for the prescribed time, measured in giga years. Then we map the bodies to the initial grid we choose. This is a small grid. We solve the problem based on boundary conditions obtained from multiple expansions. Then we use this this information to structure smaller new body problems that will be solved to enhance the accuracy in specific points. For example, in the center of galaxies, where there are thousands, millions of bodies inside, and small phenomena occur that actually affect the whole simulation. In these places, we have to refine the grid, so we have we can capture this phenomenon. Then we solve these small problems in parallel, interpolate the acceleration computed in these points back to the bodies, integrate the equation of motions, and store the simulation of data, the simulation data. These data are stored based on an interval. We cannot store in its time step because we are talking about something like 10 gigabytes per second. That kind of data. So then the post-processing phase starts. The post-processing phase crunches this data, creating snapshots or metrics concerning the bodies and physical quantities. Moreover, diagnostics are given back from the code because these types of simulations, something might easily skip. When you are handling millions of bodies, it's difficult. You have to examine the diagnostics very thoroughly to be able to come to conclusions. This code is primarily used for galaxy simulations, formation of bars and phenomena of spirals. This is an output of the simulation. This is a galaxy with a bulge in the center and a relatively hot disk. And by hot disk, we mean that the bodies involved are allowed to vibrate a little. This galaxy has formed spiral arms, and after 3 giga years, this galaxy forms a bar structure in the center, which has a peanut shape. This is not visible here, but this is actually something that was firstly observed from simulation and then found in nature. For example, in the left panel there, there is the NGC galaxy, and these are simulations we conducted and the results we obtained for galaxies having this structure. So you see that the resemblance is close. Now, what are the requirements for such a simulation, and why we believe that clouds might help accelerate the pace of research in that direction? In these simulations, usually the number of particles ranges between 10 to the 7th or 5 times 10 to the 7th particles. The inputs are about 1 to 4 gigabytes. The memory requirements are between 20 gigabytes to 40 gigabytes. The outputs are 100 gigabytes per simulation. And the running time is 48 hours for 20 cores. So if we were willing to conduct larger simulations, we might take days to get results. The post-processing is another problem. It takes 1 work week for a team to actually crunch these numbers and make viable comments on them. But as I said before, the largest problem is that these simulations have to be conducted 3 or 5 times each with slightly different parameters. So, moreover, setting up such an experiment requires specialized personnel. And in fact, this code, for example, took us 3 years in a team of mathematicians, engineers, and physicists to build. However, emerging cloud architectures, as I said, like Cloud Lightning or Workflow as a Service, can substantially accelerate these types of simulations. We can break down a simulation like that in 3 discrete parts. The creation of initial conditions, which requires small computational power and small storage. The simulation execution, which requires a lot of very large computational power and a large object storage drive. It doesn't have to be a fast drive. It just has to be large enough. And finally, the post-processing and rendering of results. If we see these 3 steps distinctively, someone could schedule these jobs in different parts of a cloud. They don't have to be scheduled on the same machine. Up to now, what we're doing is we're running a simulation, we're getting the data from the supercomputer, and then post-process them locally using GPUs or pure CPU power. A cloud could substantially enhance that. Without moving the data, someone could just change the computational hardware to, let's say, a GPU cluster and use a GPU cluster to render the simulations very fast, or even real time as the simulation runs. These three aforementioned steps, for example, in the Cloud Lightning context, can be formulated in a blueprint. So each one of them can run after the previous one has finished, always picking up the best available hardware for each one of them. This will accelerate the procedure of conducting these simulations. Moreover, this type of specialized hardware, which now enters the cloud, for example, GPUs or NVIDIA, Intel's Xeon Phi, can be used to reduce the costs of such simulations, because if you run something for 48 hours, then the power consumption will be immense. So using this low energy consumption hardware, which has a lot of computational capability, more than a CPU, we can reduce the costs of running these. Moreover, the use of clouds will, I believe that after some years, will eliminate the on-premises computations, because it's very difficult to maintain and update equipment that you bought. The cost is enormous, and minding the pace in which the new hardware comes into the market, and for example, from personal experience, the accuracy needed conducting more accurate simulations is also enormous. So the last one is that highly skilled personnel is required in today's high performance computing centers to tune these codes for specific hardware, for specific runs. If a cloud was employed in this kind of work, then there is no need for highly skilled personnel to do that. The cloud would the cloud provider will select the appropriate hardware, deploy the application under some envelope of auto-scaling that we provided from the creators of the software, and we eliminate the but this way we can eliminate the costs involved there. Finally, and the most important thing is robustness and resiliency of cloud environments. If such a simulation is stop, let's say something fails halfway through, then somebody has to reconduct the simulation from scratch. So cloud environments enable us to live migrate instances or move data or keep data in a place that it's very difficult to get lost or destroyed or somehow tainted through something. Similarly to the in-body simulations, other types of simulations can also run such environments or cloud environments. These are computational fluid dynamics codes that can be used, that are used in the car industry, in designing and manufacturing products, or dynamical structural analysis of buildings and structures, heat transfer, which is something very important, especially in designing new houses and energy efficient buildings and things like that. The finally, computational finance, which is something that arose in the last 10 years, high-frequency trading of options or binary options and these kinds of things. Moreover, another important issue is that using a cloud will substantially increase the audience that actually uses these codes. Now, for example, there are 5 or 6 codes for in-body simulation that are belonging to specific institutes. They are tuned for these institutes, they can be used only by these institutes or by a small group of people that has the access to this kind of hardware of this scale. Using the cloud or using software as a service to handle these types of applications, this will substantially commercialize more of the applications to the public and give the opportunity to new researchers to use these kinds of codes and procedures. Furthermore, there are also some potential problems in that. These types of codes, especially HPC codes, heavily depend on the network and the connection speed. So the application will run as fast as the slowest component if it's distributed. Especially for scientific computing applications, which most of them are lockstep. You cannot go to the next step if the previous doesn't finish. The performance of HPC codes is substantially affected by the noisy neighborhood phenomenon. This is something that was observed in the literature a long time ago. If two people are running on the same hardware, then the performance is degraded substantially, especially in dense computation applications, which are the ones that have the fastest performance. They're highly affected by the cache sharing phenomenon. It also, HPC codes require specialized, very large virtual instances that cannot be provisioned easily by the CSPs, the cloud service providers. When we ask for very large custom-built virtual instances, the schedulers are not, let's say, mature enough to handle this type of requirements. They induce fragmentation to the available resources. This fragmentation leads to increased energy consumption and cost to the service provider. Finally, the use of heterogeneous hardware, despite the fact that in the last 5 years it's introduced in the cloud, is not mature enough to handle this type of phenomenon. It's very difficult to share graphics processors or IntelliJ files. It's not mature enough to run to be able to run these types of simulations. Finally, the next step in this research is to, as we speak, we are developing the code for distributed systems to run even larger cosmological simulations, for example, collisions of galaxies or study phenomena of black holes inside the galaxy formations. The migration to the cloud would, as I said before, will affect, is a powerful solution for engineering and physics simulation, especially in the industry, because using the virtually unlimited and flexible resources that are available in cloud environments, the companies that actually use the simulations to produce or find new materials or conduct research on already existing materials or products will get an advantage to this. Finally, it will give easy access to highly tuned code without the need for experts for hiring specialized experts for each part of the simulation. So this will increase the pace of research and manufacturing. These are some notable references concerning the presented topic. Are there any questions?
I think it was too scientific for people to ask questions. Anyway, I think we are coming to an end of the session. Sorry.
You said, I think your codes are written on CPUs, and you're saying that moving these codes to the cloud would be easier. Because in the cloud, you would use heterogeneous resources like GPUs, Xeon, Fox. Still, your codes need to be ported to these things. Cloud will not magically execute your codes.
Yeah, of course. Porting them, but you have to have them. You have to have the cloud will give you the opportunity of having these resources and be able to execute on these resources without moving. The data is huge, you cannot move this data. It's, for example, in a series of simulations, we ended up with data close to 4 terabytes. We cannot move this data to a cluster that has GPUs from a cluster that hasn't GPUs. We have the code, but we have to, each time you have to move the data and then compute the results.
So do you have any plan to migrate all of your pipelines to the cloud, including the plan, or is it just a...
Yeah, of course. Okay. We will try to experiment. We actually, in the process of, we are waiting for access from the cloud provider in Greece, a cloud provider belonging to the academic section, to test these ideas there, to make it more accessible. You see, we build the software, we are engineers, we can run it. But the physicists cannot run it at all. This is a very, very complex code to set up and run. It's about 30,000 lines of C++ without mining the post-processing routines and all of this. So the physicist doesn't care about that. He wants to run the simulation, build the input data on the fly, and run the simulation. He doesn't care about moving the data or how they will move or how fast it will run. So it will benefit scientists that have no expertise in high performance computing, but they have to use it to actually make research easier.
Based on the simulation technology you've engineered, do you see value where that could be reused in other sectors, for example, healthcare, around diagnostic imaging, etc., in terms of simulation and potentially how that would operate and deliver things people haven't thought about yet?
For example, this type of simulation can be used also in computational fluid dynamics. If you change if you change the physical law behind it, it's the same ideas, but in a different part of the field. For example, if we change the gravitational force to electrostatic force, we can, for example, measure antenna radiation or the, let's say, electrostatic forces on the CPUs themselves, or phenomena of noise caused by, or for example, if we change this to viscosity forces, we can see how the air is affecting the air or water affects corrosion of dams and things like that. So yeah, it can be used in different types of simulations.
The framework. The
framework. Yeah.
The framework.
Yeah. The knowledge.
Is expanded.
Also, we are trying now, as we speak, we try to incorporate gas dynamics inside the code to be more, let's say, more close to the galaxies we see. So, are there any other questions? No? Thank you very much.